We hear a lot of talk about hope lately. Do you ever just listen to what you are saying or what other people are saying? We've all probably been saying it lately. I hope this virus doesn't get super, super bad again. I hope we don't have to shut things down. I hope, dear God, I hope that school starts on time for my kids. I hope that they play college football this year. I hope that we are able to have at least 60 games of Major League Baseball. I hope that 2021 is better than 2020 has been. I hope, I hope, I hope. Do you ever notice that when we're talking about hope in such a way, hope doesn't exude a whole lot of confidence, but hope more is wishful thinking. It's more of a wish. I wish that this would happen. I wish that this would go this way. I wish that my wishes would come true. So I want to kind of challenge that thinking of hope for a moment as we look at God's word this morning from Romans chapter 8. Because when the Bible speaks of hope, it does not speak of wishful thinking, but instead it speaks of confident faith. Confident faith that holds on to the promises that God has already made in the past, confident faith that lives right now in the present, and confident faith that is always looking forward to the future, looking forward to it, anticipating the future. That is what hope is about. Promises in the past, living in the present, looking forward to the future. Did you hear the words of hope that St. Paul wrote for us today? He said, I consider that our present sufferings, that is the difficulties that we go through in this life, the pain and the struggles that each of us faces in many different ways that we go through in a world that has been broken down because of our sin against God. I consider that our present sufferings, our hardships, are not worth comparing with the glory that will be in the future revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it. Why? Because in hope, that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. There's that idea of hope. Hope that our present hardships cannot even compare to the glory that awaits us. That yes, in this world in which we live, we don't know what 2021 is going to hold. And for crying out loud, we don't even know what tomorrow is going to hold. But when we are in Christ and when we are holding on to the promises that He has made, and more than that, when He is holding on to us because He has made us His children through faith in Jesus Christ, our present difficulties can't even compare to what God has in store for those who love Him, to the future glory that awaits us. And when Paul tries to paint a picture of the future glory that awaits us, he paints a picture that includes all of creation. That all of creation is going to be affected in the future and in the glory that God will bring about. But specifically, what does it mean for us? When and how will the children of God be revealed? You see, we learned last week that yes, we are the children of God. That the Holy Spirit living within us enables us to cry out to God and address Him as Abba, Father. He is our heavenly dad. He is the one who has brought us into this world. He is the one who has rescued us through His Son. He's the one who has filled us with His Spirit, inhabiting our hearts and our lives. But this children of God reality is hidden right now. But one day it will be fully revealed. What is known only to God right now, who truly are His own, who are the wheat among the weeds, who belongs to Him, one day will be fully revealed. And how and when will that be revealed? Well, Jesus in Matthew chapter 13 talked about it being revealed when the harvesters come and the angels come. And first of all, they pull up the weeds. Sometimes those weeds in the garden look a lot like that there's something good, but they're not, right? And so the angels will come and take away those who may have given the appearance of belonging to the Lord, but the Lord knows all things, and he knows who are his and who are not. And those who have rejected the Lord will end up spending their eternity separated from him. But those who have received the Lord and have put their confidence in him will be gathered together into his barn, and they will spend eternity with him. That is a picture of the last day when Jesus will come again in glory. And on that last day, he will judge both the living and the dead. He will call all nations to come before him. He will raise up the dead and gather those still alive, and all will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. And on that day, not only will it be known to the Father who belongs to him, but everyone will know who are the children of God. We look forward to that day. We can look forward to that day whenever that day comes, known only to God. We look forward to that day. Why? Because as Paul writes in another one of his books, and I think this is helpful to cross-reference here, in Philippians chapter 3, he says this: our place of belonging, our citizenship, where we really belong, is in heaven. That is in God's presence. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, who? The Lord Jesus Christ. And what is he going to do? Who, by the power that enables him to bring everything, all of creation, under his control, what's he going to do for you and for me? He will transform our lowly bodies, our broken, our sinful bodies, so that they will be like his glorious body. At another point in the book of Philippians, Paul says that so somehow we will attain to the resurrection of the dead. We can't fully understand it. But on that day, that last day when Jesus comes in again in glory, it will be a glorious sight for the children of God to be revealed. And we will be able to be like Jesus and shine like stars and shine with the glory of our Savior. Yes, all of creation on that day will be restored to its original splendor when Christ returns. People, we will walk in harmony with God. The birds will sing. The trees will grow. The plants will be filled with life. The fruit will taste good and be good for us. Even the animals will give God the glory. All of creation will be restored to its original splendor when Jesus Christ returns. That is the future that we have for us. And yet in the present, what do we do? What do we do right now? Again, past, present, and future, Romans 8 speaks of. We are anchored to the promises of God made in the past. We look forward in hope to the future that God has promised to those who love him. But what about right now? How do we live in the present? Well, Paul says that that's going to be difficult for us. You see, the Bible never promises for those who believe in Jesus that life is going to be easy. No, we are living life in the world along with everyone else in the world. And we know that life is filled with difficulties and pain and struggle. That's the way it is right now. But what do we have? We have something that separates us from the rest of the world. We have hope. Hope, very confidence in God. For we know that the whole creation, Paul says, has been groaning, complaining, we could maybe say, aching, we could maybe say, groaning and moaning and complaining as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. And now, count how many times you hear of hope. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all, for who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. So it seems that the prescription for living life in the present is to be people of hope, isn't it? To be people who place their confidence not in ourselves or in our government or in what we ourselves can do or even in the amazing things that science has revealed, But we put our hope in the living God, who is the creator of the heavens and the earth. We put our hope in Jesus Christ, crucified, risen, and coming again. We put our hope in the Holy Spirit who dwells in our hearts. We are hopeful. But understand hopeful, not hopeful, but full of hope, full of confidence. We anticipate what we have yet to experience. Yeah, people sometimes say, I can't believe in anything my eyes haven't seen. I can't believe in anything that my mind can't comprehend. I won't believe it unless I can have it proven to me. But you know what the scripture says? For those who love God, who trust in Him, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind can even conceive what God has prepared for you. That is hope. Placing your confidence in the words and promises of God found in Jesus Christ. We are filled with that kind of hope, looking forward to a reunion with our loved ones who have gone before us, and with Jesus Christ, who is there waiting for us where our citizenship is in heaven. We are hopeful. We are filled with hope. And yet at the same time, we are patiently waiting. Waiting patiently, knowing that we will be cared for remarkably well. Think about what the experience is like when you need to schedule an important appointment with a specialist, a specialized doctor, someone who is trained in a specific type of medicine, and you need their care. What do you need to do in order to be treated by them? Well, first of all, you've got to make an appointment. And so if you do go the old-fashioned way, you might call them up on the phone. And what's the first thing you got to do? Can I put you on hold for a moment, right? You've got to wait. You've got to wait. Because the person in the front office says, we got to wait. There's people that have called before you, so you're waiting. You're on hold. And then what's the next thing that they do? They look and see when they can get you in. And you say, okay, when can I get in? I'd like to see you as soon as possible. They say, well, today is the 19th of July. We can see you on September 20th, right? And so what do? You wait again. And then the day finally comes for you to go see the specialist. And what do? You go in and you check in and you have to wait again. Nowadays, you have to wait in your car until they send you a text message. But back in the day, we actually got to go in with the magazines and read magazines and wait in the waiting room. And then what happens next? They call your name. So it's time, right? The good stuff's going to happen. And you get called back to the examination room, and the nurse sees you, and they take your vital signs, and then they say what? The doctor will be with you shortly, so what do you have to do? You've got to wait. And you wait, and you finally then get to see the physician that you have been planning to see. But all the time, you're waiting, and you're waiting, and you're waiting. Because why? Because you're a good patient. You're a good patient of an even greater physician. You see how that can compare to our experience with God? That we have an amazing physician. He is the creator of the heavens and the earth, and He knows the diagnosis of each of His creatures. He knows exactly what we need, and He will provide for us. And yet patients are patiently waiting, but waiting in the hopeful confidence that we will be cared for remarkably well. Why? Because that great physician is also a good, good father, and He loves you as His child. And as we wait patiently, we call out to Him as we pray. Romans 8, 26 and 27, in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. You see, as we wait, what does He give? He gives the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is our gracious and our groaning intercessor who takes our feeble prayers, our fumbling prayers, and he brings them into the presence of the Father. He takes what we might drop and he picks it up and he runs it in to the end zone. You see, the Holy Spirit of God is there as our intercessor, our go-between. But the Bible tells us also that Jesus is our intercessor, that Jesus is our mediator, that Jesus is our go-between. So which one is it? Is the Holy Spirit helping you, or is Jesus helping you? And the answer is yes, they both are. Because why? You are doubly blessed. And as Hebrews chapter 7 says, because Jesus lives forever, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him. Because why? Because he always lives to intercede for them. You see, Jesus lives right now, and he lives for the purpose of bringing you to God and God to you, so that you can be a person of hope, banking your life upon the promises God has made in the past, living hopefully and patiently waiting in the present, looking forward to a future that is bright, because God is there shining already.